Hello, my name is Carolyn Epperson. I am the Faith Formation Coordinator here at Resurrection Parish. On behalf of the staff, I'd like to thank you for joining us tonight. As you know, this is our first session of Generations of Disciples Online. These celebrations are for everyone in the parish, so we welcome all of you. Our celebrations of GOD Online will be available on the parish website at gbres.org. For those of you with children in grades preschool through 12, we do ask that you register at the parish website. And the specific website for that will be gbres.org/God Online. As we journey together, know that we are open to your ideas, suggestions, changes you think would be helpful, because we want this to be for you, the church at the home. Our sessions will be taped, so feel free to stop them as need be and come back when it's convenient for you. We thank you for joining us, and Father Tom, take it away.
Hi, I'm Father Tom. I want to welcome you to our online virtual experience of our GOD program called Celebration. It's a wonderful time to gather as family, our children, families together, as well as those who are other members of our parish. We come together in faith and hope as one family here at Res. I want to thank you all for a time that's been happening over the last few months. It's been a challenging time. We've been trying to do our best to reach out and to take care of, especially those in need. So I want to take this moment to thank all of you. In many ways, you have reached out to those who are isolated, reached out to those who have special needs along the way. Thank you for that. I also want to thank you for keeping us as a parish going through your own prayer, time together, to your financial considerations, all the things that you've been doing to keep us as a parish going. We appreciate that, and we're here to help you in any way that we can in the future. So if anything comes up in the near future, give me a call, give us a call. We'd be happy to sit down and talk with you and help you in any way that needs to be done.
Thanks, Father Tom. We all know this is not an easy time. We're all going through many difficult moments, and many of us are stressed and feel overwhelmed, depressed at times, and we seem to give more of ourselves. We also have to take care of ourselves and other people, and that giving can be a tremendous amount of weight on us, and we ask ourselves sometimes, when's enough?
I know just what you mean. So many changes, so many demands. It takes a lot of time and energy to learn new ways. Oh, the added anxieties, the worries, the stress. Some days it just seems so unfair. I just need some peace and quiet. I get confused when life feels unfair.
It's Not Fair. Written by Amy Krauss Rosenthal. Illustrated by Tom Leichenheld. And published by HarperCollins Children's Books. In 2008. Used with permission.
Hey, how come I get the smaller half?
Aw, why did he get the bigger laugh? Hey, Dad, why can't I have a pet giraffe?
It's not fair.
Why can't I have curly locks?
I want my own box.
Why now? Chicken pox.
It's not fair. You get to stay up late. I gotta go to bed at 8.
They said they would, but they didn't wait.
It's not fair. How come you don't yell at her? Hey! It's my turn to stir.
I don't know, sir. It's all one big blur.
It's not fair.
How come she gets brand new shoes?
Aw, man. Why does my team always lose? It's not fair. How come I get these funny-looking feet? How come he gets the window seat?
Why did I get the boring sheet?
It's not fair.
How come he got an extra leg?
Why am I the only square peg?
Why must I lay all the eggs?
It's not fair. Why does he get all the flies?
How come she has all the eyes?
It's not fair.
How come I get the bottom bunk?
Why did I have to go kerplunk?
It's not fair. Wow. How come she gets all the rings?
Why do birds get all the wings?
It's not fair. Why can books go on and on, never ending, only once upons?
It's not fair.
Does being fair, being equitable, mean you always treat people equally, the same? Why or why not? Take a look at our conversation starters on this slide and hit the pause button as you take all the time your household of faith needs to think and to share with one another.
It's all about me.
Jesus reminds us all, it's never really about me. Even though it is really about me, but it's really not about me. It's about a few, it's about others, it's about working with others in our world because we can and we're able to do so. So listen to this story as he told this parable to those around him.
Hi, I'm Lily and what have we got? This Sunday is the 25th Sunday in Ordinary Time. This Sunday's Gospel is from Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 through 16a.
Jesus told his disciples this parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out at dawn to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with them for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. Going out about 9 o'clock, the landowner saw others standing idle in the marketplace. He said to them, "You too go into my vineyard and I will give you what is just." So they went off. And he went out again around noon and around 3 o'clock and did likewise. Going out about 5 o'clock, the landowner found others standing around and said to them, "Why do you stand here idle all day?" They answered, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You too go into my vineyard." When it was evening, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Summon the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and ending with the first." When those who had started about 5 o'clock came, each received the usual daily wage. So when the first came, they thought that they would receive more, but each of them also got the usual wage. And on receiving it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last ones worked only 1 hour, and you made them equal to us who bore the day's burden and the heat." He said to one of them in reply, "My friend, I am not cheating you. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what is yours and go. What if I wish to give this last one the same as you? Or am I not free to do as I wish with my own money? Are you envious because I am generous? Thus, the last will be first, and the first will be last."
The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. We just heard in our Gospel how the landowner, in a very generous way, was able to give of himself to those around him, especially those who were working in his vineyard. But each character, as we saw, they came up and realized, "No, I deserve more. I deserve this. I deserve that." They were taking care of themselves. It was all about them. Often in our lives, and we're taught to take care of ourselves, I have to have a good self-esteem. I have to feel good about myself. I have to make sure that I use my gifts and talents. I have to realize that I have something to give to the world. And we keep going back and forth inside of ourselves, how can I be, how can I be, how can I be? And something we forget often is that we are to love ourselves, as the Great Commandment says, as we love our neighbor. It really isn't about ourselves. Yes, we need our gifts and talents. Yes, we need to live our lives in a certain way that nurtures ourselves, our hearts, our souls. We need to take time for ourselves. But we really only do that so that we can be of service to others, so that we can help our neighbor, so we can be there for others in our world. There's so much happening, especially in our world today, that needs our love and support. If we're only taking care of ourselves, then what good is it going to do? We love ourselves, we love God, so that we can love our neighbors in how we work for peace, for justice, for hope in our world today. So again, as Catholics especially, we don't get to heaven and we are admitted by ourselves. The question is always, as we're knocking on the gates, who did you bring with you? How did you live your life so that others may also come here to this eternal life? How did you give of yourself, use your gifts and talents so that others may also reach out and be caring to others? That's the gift that we as Catholics, as Christians, can give not only to ourselves. It is a little bit about me, but it's really a lot about you.
Think back to our earlier discussion. Does being fair mean you always treat people the same? Hit the pause button so you can take a long look at these three drawings. Appropriate to your own household of faith, talk about what you see illustrated here. Talk about what it means. Can you think of other examples to illustrate the differences? Perhaps in education, employment, economics, housing, country of origin, race, culture, even religion. What can we do to make someone else's life better? What can we do to create more justice and peace in our world, our homes, our schools, neighborhoods, communities, and places of employment throughout our country? Hit the pause button now as you take all the time your household needs to think about these questions, to look at the pictures, and to share with one another. Peace be with you. let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace. At every Mass, Catholics offer one another the peace of Christ. What is peace? And what does peace mean to you? And what does peace look like? And when we offer each other the sign of peace during Mass, what does the peace of Christ mean? Is it only a handshake? Or does the peace of Christ mean something more? What does the peace of Christ look like? And how do we, as missionary disciples of Christ, share it with other people? How do we share God's peace with people in need of peace? How can we reduce anxieties and create more peace in our world? Pause the tape here, and as a household of faith, write down three ways you can share God's peace in our world, whether it's at home or at school, at work, or in your neighborhood. Maybe you have some other ideas. Hit pause now and take all the time you need. On the last Sunday of every September, the Vatican asks us, as Catholics, to take some extra time and energy to focus on the plight of migrants and refugees. Pope Francis asks, why are migrants and refugees shown indifference in the world's most economically advantaged countries and are too often looked down upon and considered the source of all of society's ills? What might we do here in the United States, one of the most economically advantaged countries in the world? What might we do to change this? How might we reach out and share hospitality and welcome, as we have so much that we can share?
As many of you know, I am Father Ken DeGroat. Presently, I am the co-founder of Casa Alba Melanie, which is the Hispanic Resource Center in downtown Green Bay. We work primarily with the Hispanic population, trying to integrate them more fully into our community, trying to be of assistance and help to them in the many difficulties that they have.
My name is Sister Melanie Matzka. I'm currently the director of Casa Alba Melanie, the Hispanic Resource Center in Green Bay. We exist, our center exists, because we believe in the importance of all people. And we know that Hispanics are facing unique challenges, as well as bringing wonderful gifts to this community.
Hi, my name is Maria Plasencia. I work at Casa Alba Melanie, a Hispanic Resource Center.
My name is Pilar Campos. I am a volunteer here in Casa Alba. I'm one of the original volunteers here. We opened in 2012.
Hello, my name is Eva Cruz Martinez. I was born in Oaxaca, Mexico. I came to Green Bay in 1999. I've been living in Green Bay for 20 years now. I attended Eisenhower, Edison, Preble, and graduated from UWGB in 2017 with my bachelor's in education. I am currently now working with Casa Alba as a secretary and helping as much as I can.
Racial equality and justice are the necessary basis, pillars for peace. We know the saying, if you want to work for justice, if you want to work for peace, work for justice.
Peace is not the absence of conflict. Peace is the presence of justice. It's the presence of unity. It's the presence of caring. Peace isn't just something that we say at Mass to each other. It's what we do when we leave Mass, when we leave religious education.
Peace to me would mean being able to feel comfortable wherever I go, It means that I don't feel like I'm being persecuted, or it feels like I don't have to hide from anyone or to answer to anyone. Peace to me as an immigrant means that I can go to the store or drive my car without being scared of being pulled over or asked a bunch of questions just by the way I look or the way I sound.
I just want to share a little bit about my experience coming from Mexico to the United States. Came to California, and that was in 1985, a long time ago. When I came to California, it was like walking into a new another door where it took me to another dimension. The life brought to me obstacles that I had to pass. Once that that I have children, I learned that my children were going to experience things that I was seeing every day, all the obstacles that we were facing, because being Hispanic is a different barrier that we see every day from people when they look at us. It's just kind of like, and they say sometimes in not a very good way, another Mexican, why don't they go back to their country? So I was worried about my children growing up in this kind of environment, but I thought anyways this was a better world than Mexico. Not because Mexico is bad or because I had a bad childhood. It's because in Mexico, working and making money is not the easiest. And if we were poor here or poor in Mexico, I would have a better life anyways here. So that's one of the main reasons why we do come to the United States, is because to have a better life.
It was hard to keep both cultures in a balance, because it was one that you wanted to be in, fit in, be accepted. And then also you go home and you speak Spanish only, and your parents are telling you, like, never forget where you come from, know your roots and your culture. So it was a lot to take in. While going through all that, we experienced, you know, racial discrimination. I didn't understand it at the beginning because I was young, but I would see my parents being mistreated. And I always wondered, like, why that was. And I didn't understand, but I wanted to defend them. And I just got the energy that they weren't being treated very nicely. But my parents always said, you know, like, just ignore it and move on. And then with that being said, it was just very hard. I feel like in the classrooms, when the topic of immigration would pop up, I was like the reference. I was the one that would get looked at, and that was very uncomfortable for me, because there were some harsh comments from other students that at the time I don't think they knew any better or what they were saying. But there was once a comment, you know, what should the system do with immigration? And some kids would say, like, oh, just deport them all, or use the military to kick them out. And to me, I didn't have a voice then because I was scared. I didn't want to be picked on. I didn't want to stand out from the classroom, but I took all those emotions with, and then I would go home and tear up.
So what can I do to bring peace to people who struggle? When I look at someone who I don't know, do I look at them the same way I look at my friends? If I'm in a group of people where language is different from mine, do I turn and walk away? Or do I find someone to help me understand the other language, share mine, and enter into a conversation? When I hear negative comments about other people, about another culture, do I accept those comments as true? Or do I check out the reality? And if I know that something that is being said is not true or is derogatory and demeaning, do I speak up? Am I interested in getting to know people of another culture? Do I care about what is important to them? Do I really try to see in every person the image of God?
If I could say one last thing before I head out, I would encourage everyone to come in and talk to me, to come and talk to people in the Hispanic community. The way I see it, the way I've been raised by the Hispanic community, we are a community that likes to share our culture and likes to share our beliefs and likes to share our food as well. We are a very welcoming community, and I just ask people to first come and talk to us and get to know us before jumping the gun and making some cruel judgments based on stereotypical things or just misinformation you hear in the media. I just encourage you to first come and talk to me, come and talk to anyone in the Hispanic community, and come to know us first. We are very welcoming, and we'll be very happy to have you in our community.
I want to say that you need to get to know us. As Latinos, we have different culture. We have different, even the Spanish that we spoke is different. So don't be afraid to get to know us. Once you get to know us, you are going to love us. Please eat our food. And if you have questions, don't be afraid to ask. We want to give you the right answer. And because we have so many stereotypes, and some people think that it's Mexico, and then Mexico, Central Mexico, and South Mexico, but it's not. It's Mexico, Central America, and South America. So just get us known. That is very, very good for us too. And as Father can say, if you learn one or two words, we are going to be very happy because you are trying. And it's the only thing that we ask. Just trying. We are here to live in peace as you. And we don't want to get any confrontations. We don't like to fight. We want to be very good neighbors, and we go to church like you, and it's why just get us knowing, and that would be a very good experience for you too.
After hearing from our Latino neighbors living here in the greater Green Bay area, do you have any ideas, new and different ideas, as to how you might share peace, how you might share the peace of Christ? Hit the pause button again and take some time to think and talk with one another, and then add any new ideas or examples to the list you started earlier.
Every year since 2000, the United Nations has promoted International Peace Day on September 21st. You may be familiar with the Pinwheels for Peace project. This particular project really encourages people to be people of compassion, kindness, and hope. They encourage you to make a pinwheel, put different words, images, poems, prayers on your pinwheel, and then plant it in your yard as a reminder to others to live in peace. We live in a society where we're constantly bombarded with images of conflict, war, division, etc. And sometimes we just need that little reminder to be people of peace. So this month, we're encouraging you to make your own pinwheel for peace, and then bring it back to church and plant it near the fire pit on Hilltop Drive. You will see others planted there when you come to bring yours back to church. You should have received a packet on your doorstep with the materials to make your own pinwheel. If you have not, know that we will have some available after the weekend liturgies. Feel free to pick one up for you and your family. And I hate to tell you, but when they're gone, but it would be wonderful to have you join us and bring your pinwheel back and plant it around the fire pit on Hilltop. On behalf of the parish staff, I'd like to thank you for joining us for our first celebration of GOD Online. Let's bow our heads as we join together in our closing prayer and song.
Spirit of Peace, we ask for your guidance and wisdom as we strive for peace. Inspire and enliven our efforts to make peace a reality in our war-torn world.
Grant us peace of mind and heart. Help us to make peace with the unsettled parts of our lives, and show what is means to practice love of self.
Encircle our homes with peace. Remind us daily of the value of words and actions that foster kindness and consideration.
Enrich our neighborhoods, parishes, and communities with your peace. Teach us how to listen to each other with respect and to widen our circles of compassion and caring.
Make peace a reality across the globe. Broaden our understanding and acceptance of those who belong to other nations, religions, and races.
Spirit of Peace, we thank you for your guidance and wisdom as we strive for peace. Make our efforts to be peacemakers ripple out into the world and draw us closer together as one. Spirit of Peace, we thank you for your guidance and wisdom as we strive for peace. Make our efforts to be peacemakers ripple out into the world and draw us together as one. And if you are able to share a sign of peace, a sign of Christ's peace with another person, do that now. And let us go forth to be living, breathing models of peace and justice in God's name. Let the Church of Resurrection Parish say, Amen. Amen.
Where the world is merciless,
be God's mercy.
Where the world is hopeless,
be God's hope.
Where there is injustice,
be God's justice. Be God's joy.
Where the world is doubting,
be God's faith.
Where there is ingratitude,
be God's grace.
Where there is confusion,
be God's truth.
Where there is weakness, be God's strength. Let your life change the world.
Where the world is wounded,
be God's healing.
Where the world is weeping,
be God's song.
Where the world is despairing,
be God's beauty.
Where the world is crumbling,
be God's rock.
Where there is no tenderness,
be God's child.
Where there is loneliness,
be God's smile.
Where the world is dying,
be God's light. Where there is darkness,